Watch the birdie, you bastard. Excuse me, Mr. Bond, isn't it? Who are you? I am a Hong Kong narcotics agent, and I was just asked, wondering if you could not kill Sanchez at the moment, please, because I'm currently investigating his operations. I've been setting up for years. So if we could just, if I could just finish my mission first, and then you can kill Sanchez afterwards, if that's okay. Wait, you're investigating Sanchez? Maybe we should team up, because I want to get rid of him. And if your plan involves killing him at the end, then count me in. Yeah, I'm open for Sanchez being killed right as soon as we're finished. We just need to get into the heart of his operation concerning the Asian and Oriental drug lords. And then once we've found out what's going on and stopped it, you can then kill him all you like. Excellent. Wouldn't it have been silly if you tried to knock me out with some ninja agents or something? How silly would that have been? Yeah. that would have been hilarious. I think I might have died. Ladies and gentlemen, Nick here, and welcome to my review of the 16th James Bond film, License to Kill, the second and sadly final Bond film to star Timothy Dalton as James Bond 007. And you know what? I love Timothy Dalton. I really, really love Timothy Dalton's Bond. The only really time I don't really love Dalton Bond is actually in the first bit of this movie where, I don't know, it's just not quite as good as later on where he's hang out with Felix at the wedding. But once he hears about Sanchez escaping, and when he finds the bodies of Della and Felix, with Felix still being alive but seriously wounded, that's where we get the Dalton that we love in the rest of the film. He does a fantastic job. He still does a good job in the scenes beforehand, especially in the action moments, but I think he gets even better once we get into the actual revenge plot of the film. He's not quite the same Bond as in the last film, but he's still damn amazing. I do think Dalton is amazing throughout the majority of the film. I think he plays Bond so perfectly. And even in the bits where he's not brilliant, he's still really great. And still he's still really great. And has some, has lots of great moments, especially in the pre-titles. He's so great in that. Yeah, I think his performance was better in Living Daylight, but I think he does have a bit more humorous moments in this film. There's some funny moments when he has to play very straight, and it's still really funny. So props to Timothy Dalton. This is why he's my favourite Bond. He's so brilliant in both installments that he's in, and I really wish he had the third film, maybe even a fourth film if we were lucky. But, it was never meant to be, was it? Maybe if License to Kill was the third Timothy Dalton Bond film. I know what they're doing. They're taking inspiration from late 80s, early 90s action movies at the time and doing a Bond version of that. And I think that is actually a pretty good idea, but I think we've got to build to it first. I think we should have had this as the third installment, third Dalton Bond, and had another film like Living Daylight, but starting to push the more adult tone in the second Dalton film. And then for the third one, we have License to Kill. And then the fourth one, we go back to basics. Very Living Daylights or what would have been second Bond film style, Dalton Bond film style. And then after that, we then go to GoldenEye. But as it is, License to Kill, still a really good movie. The plot sees James Bond go on a revenge mission against drug lords Fran Sanchez after originally capturing Sanchez with his friend Felix Leiter, but then Sanchez escapes and Leiter is kidnapped by his goons and partly fed into to a shark, where he loses a leg and damages an arm. Don't know how he loses the arm or damages the arm, because he's being dangled. In the books, in Live and Let Die, the book, Felix accidentally fell into the shark trap door and got his leg chopped, a bit of a leg chopped off, and his arm was chopped off, and he had to have a hook replacement. I think it was his right hand. I have to reread that passage, and I'll do a review of the Live and Let Die book at some point. So they take inspiration from that in this scene. And also, the other Ian Fleming references are to the Hindelbrand rarity, where they have they've got Milton Crest, who's the main villain of the short story. He's a bit different here, but he's here alongside with his ship, the Wave Crest. Here it's a bigger marine biologist yacht, marine biologist boat. I don't know if it's a yacht. What's in the short story? It was a book. And also the scorpion whip thing. I think it's called what Sanchez uses to whip Talisa Soto's character Lupe. What Sanchez uses to whip Lupe with in the pre-title scene that's features in the short story. There was one other short story or book reference that was in the film, but I can't remember it. Anyway, Bond starts looking for Sanchez and eventually finds out about Crest and pretty much does in the guy who sold out Felix. However, he then has a confrontation with M and effectively resigns after M tells him he cannot be allowed to continue on the revenge mission. So Bond runs away with his license to kill revoked, and now he's on the run and fighting both sides of the law, so to speak, and eventually finds and locates Crest and then heads out to find Sanchez with help from pilot Pam Bouvier, and later also joined by Q, who this is probably the most stuff Q has got to do in any of the films, or at least up prior to Spectre at least. It's really great to see Q out in the field like an Octopussy, except this time he's got a bit more involvement. He did it in Octopussy, but more personal involvement here. He supplies Bond with a whole bunch of new gadgets. And he also sticks around a couple of times to make sure Bond succeeds in the same mission. It's not really an official mission, but help make sure Bond succeeds in killing Sanchez. Eventually, Bond, after an attempt on Sanchez's life, fails due to British agent interference. There he decides to instead infiltrate Sanchez's organization as a informer in a way, try to gain his trust and start making Sanchez distrust other members of his organization, starting with Crest, and also getting rid of Heller and Truman Lodge as well. But he doesn't count on Dario, who he met at the bar where he met Pam the second time, the first time he saw her at Felix's house. But he didn't count on Dario didn't count to get rid of Dario. And Dario sort of springs him. But eventually Bond escapes with help from Pam, and after killing Dario, they go and get rid of Sanchez, and eventually they're able to kill him. That's License to Kill. It's an awesome, and also Bond does eventually get his license to kill back at the end of the film. Or at least Felix says that M was trying to reach Bond and he may have his job back for him. So he will certainly be James Bond 007 again in the next film. But anyway, so License to Kill. Awesome movie. This is an awesome movie and such great entertainment. I mean, yeah, it's not the typical James Bond adventure that we all know. Doesn't quite follow the typical plot formula, but it's a unique and interesting different take on the character, as well as also staying very true to the original Fleming books, but very much keeping to the original story, the original character, and a nice new take on the harder, darker, meaner 007 who's out for revenge more than anything, and I think that it's handled brilliantly. The first hour also moves pretty quickly, showing Bond and Leiter hanging out together at his Felix's wedding, and then pretty much shit kicking off with the villains, and then Bond going on in the revenge mission, getting his license to kill revoked, and pretty much doing all he can to disrupt the Crest's involvement. After he meets Pam, that's where things start slowing down when they get to Isthmus. But it's still handled really great, and Bond's trying to work his way up to kill both. Firstly, kill Sanchez, and then later try to weave himself into the organisation so he can get close and kill Sanchez at a later point. I will say this: Sanchez's plan is just a drug smuggling plan. It's not really a big operational thing, which seems to be a kind of a twist in some other Bond stories. Something else seems to be going on. Like recently I finished reading Solo, the 2013 James Bond book. And that story the second half of that story saw Bond going out for revenge on people who wronged him. But as we go through the book, and even earlier, before that bit, something happens to him for him to take revenge. We're getting sort of a sense that there's a slightly bigger operation going on. Something else is going on at the same time. So, you know, it's not uncommon for Bond stories, especially the book ones, to have more than one thing going on at the same time. And maybe even if it's one specific thing Bond's going after, he will usually find a second thing going on at the same time. So, yeah, that's pretty cool. It's a little bit different to what normally happens, where Bond goes on his mission and then he uncovers the bigger plot. This, though, what I meant is that he's already got this single-minded revengeness, and then he started to find something a bit bigger. And that's pretty much what happens in Solo. In License to Kill, that's not really what happens. He just has the revenge plot, and it's just Sanchez's drug plan, but it's just the drug smuggling plan. And whilst great villain plan, and certainly great to use in one where we're here, anti-drug lord films, it's not quite as interesting for Bond anti-drug lord film, where the main character is on a mission to infiltrate what's going on and stop them. No, this is Bond on a revenge mission. So if Sanchez had something a bit more sinister, like in the book Solo, or something a bit more sinister, or more, or something, a secondary operation going on that wasn't business as usual, then, well, he's not the Sanchez anyway, then it would make a bit more sense. Yeah, he's giving it to the Orientals, drug lords, but that's about as far as it goes in difference. That being said, Sanchez is a really great villain and really intimidating. And Robert Darby does a fantastic performance. I've also seen him in Die Hard, as I mentioned in that review, and also Predator 2 as FBI or CIA. As an agent there, and also as a police officer in Predator 2. And apparently he was in The Goonies. I'm not sure which role, though. I haven't seen that film. But he was outstanding as a villain in this film. He is outstanding as Sanchez. And similarly, Cary Lowell does a brilliant job as Pam Bouvier. No-nonsense pilot girl. Who also knows how to handle herself in an action situation. And Sanchez is filmed by some colourful henchmen, including Dario, who's brilliant, and played by a young Benicio Del Toro, fun fact, by the way. So, yeah, he must have been having a good time. Also got Heller, who's head of security. He's good in his scenes. Truman Lodge, who's a weedy little Accountant guy, he's funny. Professor Joe Butcher, he's a fun character, and Wayne Newton does a great job with him. Milton Crest is another great villain. He could be the second main villain, I suppose. The second villain, and Anthony Zebry does a great job with him, and it's really fun with the scenes on the wave crest where Bond pretty much ruins his operations. Although there is one bit where Crest gets out his gun, and then there's sort of a jump cut to see him shooting it. Now, some cut there were. I have the original theatrical cut on DVD, and there are some cuts or edits that make the two chop out a few seconds that were later added back onto the Ultimate Edition DVD and the Blu-ray. This was made so that the film wouldn't get an 18 certification when it came out in cinemas, and so it would pass at 15. More on that later. When the cuts were added back into the re-release, the 2006 release, then the film remained at its 15 rating. But I don't think that particular bit was to remove a cut, because it's just shooting a gun. Getting a gun out and firing it. There was obviously, by the looks of it, it was two shots, or there was a fumble, or there was a little bit of a time gap or something, and then they cut it. So, yeah, that or the camera went a bit funny when the gun was shot. Yeah, sometimes that happens in Doctor Who, where the screen just goes a bit fuzzy and something. But in this case, it's just like, it looks like there's a bit of a jump cut for some reason. So I just wanted to point that out. I don't think it was a cut made for the film edit. And if it was, then maybe someone who's got the 2006 Ultimate Edition or one of its re-releases or the Blu-ray can probably tell me what was in that gap, what was cut. But I think it was a jump cut, as opposed to something being edited out. Speaking of it being the theatrical cuts, the song at the very end sounds a bit different to how I know it online. And yeah, sometimes songs can sound different online, but this version sounds really different. The opening song sounds fine though; that's good. But the end song doesn't sound like what it's supposed to have sounded like, or at least not how it does nowadays. So, yeah, I kind of wish I got the Ultimate Edition or the Blu-ray. Never mind. And also, speaking of Ultimate DVD, this DVD has possibly the worst DVD menu of the special editions, or at least all of the ones I've got. I can't comment for some of them. Because I've got either the Ultimate Editions or the Blu-ray. But for the what special edition DVDs I've got, this has got the most boring DVD menu. What, did you just get lazy by the time you got to this film? And it wasn't even the last special edition release out. Excluding Die Another Day, the last one was technically Tomorrow Never Dies. So that had a very good one. So yeah, they just got lazy for this one. Ultimate Edition and Blu-ray versions of that's fine. That's standard. That's standard business as usual for all of them. Anyway, back to the film. Some fantastic cinematography, some fantastic editing, great direction from John Glenn, and this would have been a good one for him to go out on. It was actually, but I don't think he was going to do a sixth Bond film after this. But yeah. But it was a great way for him to go out, and certainly some brilliant stuff. And David Tennyson returns as Felix Leiter after Live and Let Die, even though we had John Terry in the last film. But you know what? David Tennyson's better, so I'm not complaining. He's possibly the best Felix Leiter. It's him or Jeffrey Wright in the Daniel Craig films. We'll see after Bond 25, but certainly Wright's brilliant in Casino Royale and Quantum of Solace. One of the few good things about that film. The latter film. And Q is once again fantastic. Yeah, getting his most stuff to do in a Bond film pre-Spectre. And yeah, although I do think Desmond Llewellyn's best performance would be in the next Bond film, even but that would be more for a typical Q scene. Whilst this time it's a bit more, he gets to do a bit more than just give Bond his weapons, and not just in the Q branch. I do have to say, is presented as a dick, a big dick. I mean, I can understand him being annoyed at Bond going rogue, or or trying to do his own thing and not obeying orders, and eventually remove him of his license to kill. But the way that this M is presented is kind of a bit of, is very dickish, especially after after him being a bit more of a, being a bit friendly to his Bonds in the previous three films, more so with Roger Moore Bond's film. The way he was with Dalton in the previous film is a bit better. It's a bit closer to Robert Brown, Bernard Lee's incarnation. So I'm actually kind of glad that he gets replaced in the next film. Although, again, it would have been nice to have seen him and Caroline Bliss get a bit more time as M and Moneypenny alongside Dalton's Bond before being changed over. But, yeah, but if this is how M's going to be towards Bond, then how Robert Brown's M is going to be towards Bond, then I'm glad that Judi Dench's M took over for the next film. But, yeah, and also there's one scene with M and Moneypenny filmed at M's office. This is the only scene set in the UK, but not filmed in the UK, unless maybe they filmed that quick bit off Whitehall quickly, unless that was stock footage from a previous installment. And the set was probably in Mexico, at the Mexican studio, because they were filming in Mexico and the United States and at the Mexican studio. So, yeah. I do have to say one member of the cast is pretty weak, and that is Talisa Soto as, what's her name? I've forgotten it again. Lupe. Talisa Soto as Lupe. She's pretty weak. What, you can get a better actress from a Spanish or Portuguese speaking country in South America or Central America to play the role? You, this is the best one they could get. This is the Jake Lloyd of License to Kill. This is the best they could get, and what we got was weak. Yeah. I mean, she's not annoying like Jake Lloyd. She's just not very good and uninteresting. Her character's pretty good. With a she's actually the kept woman story is handled well, but the actress herself just isn't that great. She's beautiful, no doubt about that, but she's not a good actress, not from this film anyway. I mean, she tries, bless her, and she's good, she's okay in the sad bits when she's crying and stuff, but when she in other times she's just not very that, she's not very good. She's really the only weakling with the cast. Another problem I do have with the film is the bit where Bond's about to assassinate Sanchez and he's interrupted by British agents who disguise themselves as ninjas, and it just goes a bit silly there. It goes pretty silly. A bit with the British agents trying to stop Bond, and because they want to, well, for starters, M doesn't want him going after Sanchez. Second, there's Hong Kong-operated British agents who are trying to get to the heart of Sanchez's operation and either disrupt it or find out what's going on to then alert the authorities. Well, actually, in this case, maybe not that latter one. But yeah, the Hong Kong necrotics. So they're trying to get to the operation. What could have been a good idea is that maybe if they teamed up together in Bond, instead of trying to assassinate Sanchez, he teams up with the Hong Kong neurotics and they try to get, and they help him infiltrate Sanchez's base a bit more alongside with the main necrotics agent who's pretending to be, his cover is another drug lord. And together they're able to disrupt Sanchez's operation, and you could have the female British agent as another one of the Bond girls that Bond could get close to, and also another British female agent who would have a lot to do in the stuff. I mean, yeah, as for the other guy, he might die, and also the necrotics leader, he might get killed in the action as well, but I could see the female agent surviving. Yeah, that might have been an interesting idea to go down, Bond teaming up with the Hong Kong neurotics, and technically he's still not really on his own mission, he's still going rogue, but he's got a plan with these guys. But instead, no, they've got to have a bit of a intermission where they kidnap him and try to have him sent back to London before Sanchez finds them and kills them all apart from Bond. And for some reason, the girl agent I was talking about, who was one of the ninjas along with the other guy, with a guy agent, she takes over the movie for about a quarter of a minute, half a minute, for some reason. Yeah, and another reason why she should have had a bit more involvement with the main story. Again, and also it would have developed the characters a bit more, apart from just being Hong Kong neurotics slash ninjas. One of them takes over the movie for about half a minute. But that's really my own, those are really my only problems with it, apart from the fact that it does feel a bit different to the normal Bond film. But you know, after and some other silly bits I'm going to mention to you in a minute. In fact, I'll mention the other silly bits. Now, the other silly bits is after that bit that I've just talked about, Bond is then taken in by Sanchez, which leads him to then start to take down Sanchez from the inside. But when he wakes up on his recovery, he wakes up and there's a great big giant fish face on sort of a fish thing right there in front of him. And his room's full of things with faces on, and it's weird. This is around the time where the film has a couple of silly moments. And at the very end, when Bond and Pam are in the swim pool and they're kissing, the camera pans over to a statue of a fish. Okay, that's fine. That's not a problem. Then the fish winks. What the fuck? What were they thinking? What a ridiculous way to end the most serious Bond film on, with one of the silliest things in a Bond film. Forget the double take pigeon. This is a what? What? In the last film, they deliberately cut a scene because they felt it was a bit too silly for Dalton's Bond, where he got help from a local in Tangier and rode a carpet across the telephone wires, and it was a bit too comedic. And that was something that was probably written in for Roger Moore's Bond if he had stayed for that film before he decided to step down from the role after A View to a Kill. So, yeah. And yet this film does a couple of things that are even sillier than the last film, and not to the extent of making it more serious or grounded. No, they're just weird. Just have another double-take pigeon and you're basically in Moonraker territory again. But besides some silliness and Talisa Soto being bit wooden and the ninjas just taking over the movie for no reason, then License to Kill is still a really great and really enjoyable movie. I mean, yeah, it is very different to what a Bond film normally does. And yeah, but after watching American action films of the late 80s and the early 90s, such as the Die Hard and Lethal Weapon films, when I rewatched this film the time before last, I had a bit more of an appreciation for License to Kill after watching those films. I liked it even more, and I liked it even more on the rewatch as well, because I was finding it really enjoyable and really fun. And first hour was a very fast-paced story, and it kept my interest. Second one kind of slowed it down a bit, but it's still pretty important, and still has a lot of brilliant moments, even if there's a couple of silly things as well. The second hour onwards has quite a few silly stuff, but yeah, and also the bit where Pam's not allowed to use her plane for some reason. I don't know why that scene was included. They could have cut that scene and she could, it's just an excuse to use a different plane to the one they had earlier. But then again, that's not a problem. You could just have something else. So yeah, I think that bit could have been cut. But, you know, besides a few minor problems and a few couple of nitpicks and some pretty annoying points, License to Kill is a really great, really entertaining and brilliant film with lots of great characters and plenty of great acting, apart from Talisa Soto, and some really great stuff going on. And it's certainly a highlight of the Bond era, for better or for worse, depending on who you ask. Yeah, and it's definitely the most different Bond has ever gone in terms of a Bond story, formula, style, in a way. It's not perfect, but I think a few more tweaks and it probably would have been really, really something special, even if it was very different to what came before and what would come after. So I'm going to give License to Kill a 9 out of 10. Please don't bet that you'll ever escape me. But a really great film. I think it's brilliantly done, and I had a really great time with it, and lots of good times. And yeah, I would love to have seen Timothy Dalton do another Bond film, maybe even two. They had started work on a film that was going to be called A Whisper from Hell, which MI6 did an article on alongside a original second act draft of Tomorrow Never Dies. So I think those articles have been taken down though, but I've still got some pictures on the one of my computers. Another thing they might have done would be a story with using the title The Property of a Lady. By the way, License to Kill was the first film not to have a title from a Fleming book. But License to Kill kind of is quite synonymous, whatever that word means. It's kind of a Bond reference in its own way. And also it does still contain some Fleming story elements. And the original title was License Revoked, but it was changed due to American audiences thinking that might be has something to do with cars. So yeah, which led to probably the worst promotional artwork or posters for any of the Bond films, because they had so little time, they decided to put so little effort into what time they did have. The poster I'm using for this review's picture is probably one of the stronger ones. I got one on my wall poster on just in front of me now, and that same poster is in my Bond postcard collection, and it is this one. That's my postcard, and it's also the one that's on my poster in the wall over and to my right. But the one that's being used in this review at the front is honestly one of the stronger ones. There could honestly have been better. It could have done better artwork or better photoshopped it. Well, maybe not photoshopped, but photographed posters. But sadly, they didn't. The timing seemed to have been a thing. But that's a shame. What's also a shame is that this film didn't make enough money, and that meant that it mainly possibly due to the age rating of it being a 15 in the UK and a PG-13 in America, and also the dark tone that influenced those ratings. It was also cut to make sure it got the PG-13, not the R rating, by the way, in America, by the way. And also, they had a very strong competition. 1989, summer movies were all the rage in 89. And it was a very big year for summer movies. The highest grossing film that year was Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. You also had Back to the Future Part 2, Batman, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, The Little Mermaid, Lethal Weapon 2, that also had composer Michael Kamen on, and also possibly had some inspiration from it. And speaking of which, Michael Kamen's score for this movie is a fantastic score. I was about to say outstanding. I don't know if it's quite there yet, but I certainly think it's fantastic. He does a very strong score, and I would have liked to have seen, heard him come back for the next Bond film if John Barry wasn't returning. That wasn't the case. We've got someone else, and he's not quite as great. But Michael Kamen does a brilliant job with License to Kill's film score, and it's certainly my favourite of his film scores that I've heard. I'm definitely taking some inspiration from his Lethal Weapon ones, and also using that inspiration and from those ones in his Die Hard film scores as well. But License to Kill didn't do very well financially for one reason or another, or a combination of all of them, and the film was not targeted as not even a family audience, let alone children's. It was always going to be an adult film, so they would lose half the viewership that the other films would have gotten. So Eon was in financial difficulties, and that meant that for six years, they could not make a Bond film. They were able to start work, instead of being able to start work on what would have been 1991's Bond film, they were kind of stuck until about 1994, and they wanted Dalton in for a third film, but after waiting so long, he declined. And as sad as it is to have Dalton leave after only two films, and to have such a big gap between films waiting, then I can understand why. This is I'd also understand if Daniel Craig had left if they delayed Bond 25's filming too long. Although, and he's had four films, so it makes sense he could stick around for one more before coming back. But it's a shame Dalton didn't. So the story that they had got for what would have been Bond's third film, Dalton's third Bond film, for 1990, the 1994 one, that is, then that became what would be the what we now have as the 17th James Bond film, but it would be the first one with the fifth actor playing it and would be released in the following year of 1995. In the more lucrative, profitable month of November for a Bond film, although I don't know if 1995 had a bigger summer as 1989, though. So this history lesson comes to a close with me saying thank you for watching my review of License to Kill. Tune in next time where I'll be reviewing the 17th James Bond film released in 1995, starring Pierce Brosnan as the fifth actor to play James Bond in my second favourite James Bond film of the entire series, GoldenEye. And I'm really looking forward to this one. I don't like this cover though, I don't really like the cover. As yeah, but ignoring the but again, this one, not a very good DVD, didn't have a very good DVD menu. This one doesn't have a very good cover, but DVDs aside, the film is fantastic. Woo! I'm really looking forward to it. Anyway, thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. 't forget to click below to subscribe to the official Nicholas Payne Retro YouTube channel. So, excuse me, hang on, give me a second. But I do. Stop burping. Might have been a reference to, I think it might be property or related or something. I can't remember. Anyway, so Bond then pursues Sanchez. Well, starts looking for Sanchez. What, you couldn't get another Spanish or Portuguese country speaking, so it's speaking country. Sorry, what, you can get another country that had Spanish or Portuguese speaking people, actress from one of the. What, you can get an actress from another Spanish or Portuguese speaking country. Fuck. What, you can get it, but she's just not that interest. She's not that good of an act. She's not very good as an actress. And second, well, mainly because he doesn't think Sanchez is their problem, and it might compromise the British government. And secondly, the Hong there's some Asian British it says Hong Kong agents working for the UK so Hong and I mean just another just I mean just throwing another double take push I mean throwing a double just throwing a yeah and like the and that was certainly something more for the Roger Moore Bond film if they for Roger Moore's Bond if they got him in before he steps down. Before it, sorry, where, and it was so, and that was something that they were certainly probably going to use if Roger Moore was. Sorry, excuse me, going to have a difficult edit with this one. So, yeah. And this history lesson comes to a close with the announcement of the next Bond film and who will be playing him. The next in one of my favourite Bond films, my second favourite. I'll see you guys next time. So I'll see you guys for whatever comes next. So the next James Bond film we will be reviewing will be GoldenEye. And I really, really can't wait to... Okay, thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Oh, fuck you. Yeah, I'm going to have a very difficult edit, aren't I? Yeah. Anyway, thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye. Gonna go here. This isn't quite accurate. Wait, you're in the Sanchez case as well? Okay, what? Yeah, I know.